Hi everybody, very welcome to Mentour and yet another video podcast. As always, I hope you're doing absolutely fantastic. Today on the video, guys, is there a safest seat in an aircraft? What should you be thinking about in order for you to maximize your safety when you're flying? And do you need to do anything extra if you're sitting by an emergency exit? Stay tuned.
Wind 31016, 31 right,
set on. Third land, 31 right.
Delta 260 is produced.
This video is brought to you by brilliant.org. Now, if you're like me and you've been spending the last month or so in the hammock, not really using your brain, but school is coming up or work is coming up, well, then you need to start to activate your brain. And Brilliant is a perfect tool to do just that. They have daily challenges that will give you, you know, 5 minutes a day to really start working on things. And the five and the first of you who uses this link here below will get a whopping 20% off the annual fee of Brilliant, but it's completely free to go and check it out. So do that. Right, guys, so safest seat in an aircraft. You probably heard about this before or read articles about it. So does such a thing exist? Well, the reason that I wanted to start talking about this was because there was an airline just last week that got into trouble because one of their employees decided to enter into their Twitter feed which seat the passengers should be using in order to have the highest survivability rate. Now, for obvious reasons, that's probably not a smart thing to do if you are a representative of an airline. And why is that not a smart thing? Well, there has been various articles about this going back for the last 10, 15 years, probably as long as there's been aircraft, really. And they have all come up with different things. Basically, the most famous one, which is the one you'll probably find whenever you Google on this, is an article that Time magazine did back in 2015. And they did a study based on 17 different events, ranging from 1985 up to, I think, 2002. And they used incidents where there had been aircraft crashing and there had been a mix of people surviving and not surviving. And based on that, they started looking into the statistics of how safe each and every seat in an aircraft was. What they found was that the seats in the back of the aircraft, specifically the middle seat in the back of the aircraft, was slightly safer than the ones in the middle and in the front of the aircraft. So the cheaper seats, the ones that tend to go last and back, they were statistically safer. So what's the issue with this then? Should you always be booking those seats if you're a nervous flyer, if you feel that you want to optimize your safety? Well, the problem with statistics, guys, is that statistics is only as good as the statistical material that's being used, right? So basically, the more statistical material you have, the more accurate the statistics will become, the more accurate the study will be. So if you have 100,000 events, it's going to be better than 10,000. And if you have 10,000, it's going to be better than 1,000 events. And the reason is that the less material you have, the more likely it is that what you see inside of your study might be affected by individual events. Like, for example, what happened during the crash? Was it an aircraft that slid off a runway? Did they fly into a mountainside? Was it a fire event? These kind of things, okay? Which is going to have a high impact on, for example, survivability in case it happens, right? So this study that Time magazine did only had 17 events and it spanned over 15 years. What you should be asking yourself is, why was the statistical material so poor? And the answer to that is, it was so poor because there were so few events. There were so few deadly crashes that kind of corresponded to the type of events that they wanted to use. And what does that indicate? Well, that indicates that what they're studying is an extremely safe mode of transport, right? And even though that statistic that we're using is correct from a statistical standpoint, it still doesn't really indicate anything. The only thing it says is that, listen, what they should have been saying is, we can't answer this question because we don't have enough statistical material to give you any meaningful view. Obviously, that wouldn't have, you know, pulled so much people to read the article. So this is what they did instead. And this is what you'll find if you go through and try to find any other studies on the subject. There is two bad or too poor statistical material. And the reason for that is because if you look at the lifetime risk of dying in a car accident, for example, that global statistics indicate is about 1 in 112. So almost 1% risk of that. If you look at the same statistic for dying in an aircraft accident, it's about 1 in 8,000. So why are we not asking what is the safest seat in a car, or in a bus, or in a train, or in a boat? Well, the reason for this is that we are always fascinated in the aviation industry. And whenever there's something happening, especially an accident of some sort, it's being blown up into the media and huge. It can dominate the media cycle for weeks. While if, let's say that 300 people would perish in a horrible aircraft accident, obviously that deserves a lot of attention. But the same attention is not given to the same amount of people dying in a war zone conflict or by drought, for example. So it's slightly skewed. And what this has meant is that about one third of humanity, about 1 in 3 people, are now nervous flyers to some extent. Some people are extremely nervous flyers. Other people are a little bit nervous and feel a little bit of discomfort. And of course, all of this, including this video to some extent, will make you potentially more nervous. Because if you start thinking, what is the safest seat? The next thought is going to be, so the other seats are unsafe? Or is it unsafe to fly? And that's not what you should be thinking, right? There are ways that you can improve on your own safety. Because of course, the aviation industry is not perfect. We do have incidents happening. It's very, very rare, but they do happen. So what can you do then? Should you be looking at what seats to sit in? My answer to that is no, right? The seats in an airliner flown by a reputable company that is being checked by good aviation authorities is equally safe no matter where you sit in the aircraft. Right. But what you should be doing is you should be paying close attention to, for example, the safety briefing. Right. So all of you now who's flying regularly would be kind of looking the other way and thinking, oh, yeah, the safety briefing. They don't say anything new, do they? But the thing is, if you would look into the cockpit and you would listen to me briefing my first officer, you will notice that even though I fly the same departure out of my home base every day, I still do a full briefing of how to do that. I brief what would happen in case we have an engine failure. How would we fly? Where would we go? What would we think about? What's the threat today? Maybe there's VFR traffic around, visual, smaller traffic. Maybe there are thunderstorms in the area. Maybe there is birds around the airport. We brief this, even though we know these things by heart, even though we've flown the same departure every single day for years, we brief it anyway. And we do that because we need to activate our brains. We need to think about the scenario ahead. We need to think, okay, so what if this happens? Because if we have done that, it is more likely that we're going to react in a quick and effective way if it does happen. Now, 999,000 out of one, nothing will happen. Okay, and we will just fly this departure like we've always done. But on the last one, that briefing will help. And you should be thinking exactly the same about the emergency briefing that the cabin crew gives you. when they brief about where the life vests are, have you ever actually reached down and felt underneath your seats to see if the seatbelt or the safety vest is there? You know, how does it feel? How would you actually take it out in case you need to? Don't do it, by the way, but you will feel where the opening is. Have you, when they say, where is your closest exit? Have you actually looked up, looked forward or back to see, you know, where would you go in case you would need to evacuate? Next time you fly, I would encourage you, even if you are not a nervous flyer, even if you're just a casual flyer that, you know, likes it, do that. Take those extra 2 minutes out of your iPad time to look through it and just prepare yourself. So in case that happens, if we have a rejected takeoff, then this is what I will do. You know, the one time that you'll need it, you will wish that you had. Okay, good. So, conclusion. Safest seats in the aircraft is whatever seat that you find comfortable, providing that you listen to your cabin crew when they do it. Another question that actually has come up from specifically nervous flyers is, do you have to do anything extra if you sit by the emergency exits? And the answer to that is, yes, you do. If you sit by the emergency exit, you are most likely going to get a specific briefing by a cabin crew member. They are going to ask you if you're willing to help in case of an emergency, and they are going to tell you to read carefully the instructions on how to open the emergency exits. And if you do, please do that. And once again, you picture yourself, you know, okay, I have to reach in and I have to pull that down, or I have to take the whole emergency exit and throw it out. Do think through it, because you don't want to be paralyzed and trying to figure out what to do if that would actually happen 5 minutes later when you're about to take off. So if you're sitting by the emergency exit, yes, you will have better leg room, but you also have a responsibility towards your fellow passengers to know more or less what to do. And if you're not comfortable with that, then don't book an emergency exit, okay? Great. Now, if you are a nervous flyer watching this and you think, oh, I have so many questions to ask this guy, then go in, get the Mentour Aviation app. There are download links down here, okay? There is a specific forum inside of the Mentour Aviation app called Nervous Flyers. And in there, there are people like me who will happily explain things to you. There is even trained psychologists that are there from time to time and ask, well, will answer your questions for you. But it's also a lot of people who are nervous flyers that will be able to support you. So get the app, go in, be active inside of the forum, and I'm sure that it will help you. Okay. So I want to thank Brilliant.org, who is the sponsor of this episode. There's a reason that I keep pushing Brilliant.org. And that's because when I was younger, I was struggling with mathematics and physics myself. But I knew that in order for me to become an airline pilot, which was my goal, I needed to master those subjects. I would have loved to have something like Brilliant.org that could have helped me in a, you know, in a fun and interactive way to get my brain working in those subjects. So for those of you who feel like you are interested in these subjects, or you do need to improve in these subjects, you might not want to become a pilot, but you might want to become something else that requires good physics knowledge, mathematical knowledge, or you might just be curious. Well, then the 501st of you who uses this link here below will get 20% off the annual fee of Brilliant. But once again, it is completely free to go and check out the different courses and see if it's something for you. So do that. Now, before I go, make sure that you have subscribed to the channel and that you have highlighted the little notification bell. It's important that you highlight the bell, because if you don't, then whenever I do live streams, for example, where I answer your questions live, or if I put out an extra video that might not come on a Friday, might come on Tuesday, for example, if there's something urgent that's happened, well, then you won't know about it. So make sure that you highlight the little bell, okay? Leave a like if you like the video, leave a comment below if there's something you want to ask me about. And if you really want to ask me something and you want an answer, well, then go into the Mentour Aviation app and become a premium member. Now, premium member, you will be able to ask me directly inside of the app live streams that I do regularly. On YouTube, I do live streams maybe one every other week or so. But in the app, I go in from time to time and do live streams. And the premium members will be able to ask questions in there. Everyone will be able to watch the live stream, but only the premium members will be able to ask questions. You will also have access to, you know, extra videos that I do. Videos that maybe are a little bit sensitive that I won't put out on the YouTube channel. Or just like the new video that I've just released today, you know, go in and have a look. I'm not going to say what it is, but it's available for premium members. Have an absolutely fantastic day wherever you are, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.